Hi. How many of you haven't seen me before? Oh, no, Elizabeth, we met all the time. Oh, okay. Well, how many of you are under 12? Okay, two. And how many of you are between 12 and 15? Oh, okay, that's both of it. And how many of you are between 17 and 20? I'm sorry, 22, that's college graduation. Okay, how many of you are older than 22? Oh, that's very good. How many of you are older than 50? So we have some 50 guys, and that's fantastic. And my name is Janming Ho, and I'm 55. Yes, that old. No, you're absolutely right. And today, I'm really happy to be with you. Unfortunately, I need to get back to my own church tonight, so I don't know if I'm going to see you again. That's in the hand of God, and I trust that He will make the best arrangement. And so what we are going to do tonight is I want to share something about myself, and I want to share something about God. Before I start it, I want to tell you something about myself. I was in the college and post-college group in this morning during the discussion, and I heard their sharing about their struggles, about the challenge that faced their life and their decision and so on and so forth. Then I realized I actually been through them all. Everything that they talk about, I had a similar experience when I was younger, in their age. Then I thought about my growing up. Many of you, two of you, I guess, are still in elementary school, so most of you are in middle school, high school, and some of you, a bulk of it, are in college and just college graduated. And I thought about my life. I thought about how I come about knowing Jesus. People have asked me that question in the morning, and I gave a short answer. And I thought about something. I thought about my life, from my birth. And I thought about that I feel like it's a U-shaped thing. It's a U-shaped thing. It's like when I was young, like really young, like 2, 3, 4, 5. Actually, I was quite happy. Nothing to worry about. Well fed. I never got cold. Just happily around. Maybe a bit naughty, but just like any 4-year-old. Sometimes you break something. Sometimes you cry, right? But when I started my elementary school, and then the simplicity of my youth started to gradually changed. I still remember when I was much younger, when I look at the sky, when I look at flower, I just feel that it's wonderful. I just feel that it's amazingly beautiful, simple, and yet complicated. I feel intuitively there's something beyond us. The world is not simply what we just see. But as I grew older, that sense of amazement and the wonder start to disappear. And when I reached the age of 8, suddenly one day a thought came to my mind. Maybe it was there already, maybe it was hidden. But that thought started to burst out. That thought was this, that wait, someday I'm going to be separated from my families forever. I was 8 years old, and I thought about my father, I thought about my mother, my brothers, my sister. And then I could not help but crying. There is something seems like inevitable. That I was 8, by the way, that I'm going to get old. No, and they are going to get older before me. And they are going to die. And they are going to be gone. And I will never have a chance to talk to them again. And from that thought, and then came to another thought that I am going to disappear sometimes from this world. How many of you had that similar thought when you were in elementary school? Yeah, you see, I told you that I had the same experience as you did. And then I started to think about why I'm here in the world. I mean, why does the world need me? Or why do I need the world? Why am I here doing what? For what? And that question troubles me from my second grade elementary school date all the way until I came to the United States. Eventually, Jesus found me. So how many of you have been troubled by that question? Why you are here for? I mean, why exactly what you are doing? And I will share with some more thought with you. So I was struggling, I was not happy, you know, because gradually I'm more and more convinced that when we are gone, when we are dead, there's nothing. When I say nothing, I'm just not talking about physically nothing. I'm talking about nothingness, nothing. That there's no thought, there's no idea that I exist, there's nothing. And that's a very, very troubling thought. At times I thought it cannot be, there must be something supernatural. But as I grew older, I'm more and more convinced through the education that there is nothingness beyond death. And so I was happy for the moment, and whenever that thought came to my mind, I got depressed. Now, I did have a normal life, by the way. What, if you ask me what was my dream when I was in elementary school? Well, to get in the best high school. And what's your dream when you got into high school? Well, get into the best college. And if possible, have a girlfriend. That's important too. I had both, and certainly did not bring me much happiness. I did enter the best university. And I did have a girlfriend, but both of which did not bring me what I desire. No. And I wasn't happy even in college, because the next question. Now, all my life, my parents, my uncles, my family told me that, you know what, all you need to do is to study hard and work hard and make sure that you do well in the school. Look how hard I work so that you can have a good education. If you don't get a good education, you are not going to make it in the world. You are not going to be a brick worker. You're too weak, you cannot pick up bricks. And so how many of you had the same experience? And then, in my high school year, I practically stopped talking to my parents. At that time, other than some short conversations, it seems like whenever we have a deep conversation, it's always in high volume. It's always a shouting match. Got angry, frustrated. I actually really did not think my parents understand me. It seems like all they want is to make sure that I do well in school and don't get into trouble. Don't date. Okay. Everything can wait until you get your good grade and you get into college. No. And then we will think about it. So how many of you have the similar experience? That you start talking to your parents around the age of high school, that at least you don't have a good, you know, a sincere conversation. No, and I was frustrated, I was angry. And along the way, that frustration and anger was enhanced by my increasing conviction that when I die, there's nothingness. So I really do not know why should I be nice to anybody, or why should anybody be nice to me? So what exactly is the point? What exactly is the point for me to get into the best college? So in that time, I wouldn't say suicidal because I never caught myself, but the idea of ending my life came across my mind often, even though it never dwelt upon it or actually put into practice. So how many of you have thought about ending your own life? Not necessarily actually doing it, you know, it just went through your mind, say, eh, might as well, just gone. Yeah. No. So see, I know how you feel. Yeah. Now, all along, even though I'm increasingly convinced there's nothingness, but just from time to time, that I just feel that the world, there's something beyond. There's something out there. Even though I could not describe it, even though I could not really realize it, don't know how to say it, no, I don't even know how to describe how I feel, but it just got that deep down conviction somehow in the midst of this darkness, a sense of nothingness, and feel frustrated, angry, you know, and still studying and keeping a good grade. Well, not necessarily a good grade, skip that part, but keep on studying. And along the way, it's just that there's something seems to, how should I say, embedded, inherent, hidden, rooted. Now, deep down in my soul, there's something that keep on, from time to time, yelling at me, say, you know what, there's something beyond this. No, life is not just that. Now, one thing that happened, then I entered college. In the midst of this dark life, my own dark life, you know, I thought about a lot of things, you know, including this. If there's God, how do I know there is God? Have you ever asked yourself that question? Now, suppose there's God. What would God do to convince you that he actually is God? Have you ever thought about that? Yeah, see, right? So whenever particularly this year, when I came here and noticed this widespread edge group, then I suddenly realized that I actually experienced everything that you have experienced. Oh. And so in college, I did something very, very terrible that to this day I still remember. No, I tutored a student, you know, to get some income for myself. So I tutored a student who was in middle school. And so I tutored. So she was 15. And her grandma passed away. So one day I went there, you know, didn't realize it, you know, ready to study. Then she was crying. And I thought, wait, why? What happened? No. She said, oh, my grandma passed away. Oh, I'm so sorry that your grandma passed away. And then she asked me, teacher, where's my grandma now? And I told her, well, nothing is. Nothing. And I told her in a straight face, by the way, with all sincerity. No. And she cried even louder. I look at her with wonder and said, what am I supposed to do? Tell you there's something else? When there's nothingness, there's nothingness. And I actually say that to her again. There's something in me that makes me feel that I cannot lie. I don't know why, but I don't want to say something I don't believe. No, I feel that's dishonest. And that's how I actually feel when I was in college. I wasn't happy. No, I did a lot of things that college students at that time did. Well, you would say the party college student. So I went to dance parties, I drank, I gambled. No, I did a lot of stuff. And all along, I feel this pull. The sense that there's nothingness, I mean, whatever that I do, it really doesn't make any difference. No, actually, at that time, I thought whatever humanity does, it doesn't mean anything, because everybody's going to be gone. And everybody was going to be nothingness. The whole humanity, there's no point. The life is seriously a ridiculous joke. You know, if you really believe that, I mean, you will do a lot of stuff and never feel happy. But nobody can be happy under such circumstances. It's not hard to envision. And I wasn't happy. But there's another pool, like I say. There's something deep down in me and saying that, you know what, life, no, there's something. I'm here. I mean something. No, I'm significant in some way. I don't know how. I don't know what. No, but this life is not an illusion. Life is not emptiness. There's something about it. I just cannot grab it. I was very, very frustrated. No, that I really want to know, but I have no clue. No, so that was my college years. At that time, I finally decided, you know, the best way to do is to have a short-term goal. Don't think about it. No, I still need to study. No, and you still need to pass this exam, that exam. You know, just go with the flow. No, don't think about it. But you know, something like that enter your mind, you can never don't think about it. It stays with you. Even if you want not to think about it, you couldn't. It came back. So I wasn't happy. And nevertheless, I thought a lot about how could I know God. No. And it was after I graduated, entered the army, broke up with my girlfriend. No, my high school girlfriend already broke up. So now it's my college girlfriend. You know, so I actually don't think it's a good idea to have a girlfriend too early. But if you do and you break it up, don't feel too bad about it. No, journey goes on, seriously. No, but at that time, sounds easy, but at that time I was heartbroken, right? And that's when something that came to my mind, that I was lying on bed, looking into the sky, look at the sky, the stars, when I was young, I liked to look at. And I thought about the idea of God. Then I thought about something. I said, well, you know what? If there's God, if actually he's a God, right? Not me, but a God, right? Then it would be a lot easier for him to find me than I find him. Right? And if there's God, the best way for anybody to know God is for him to introduce himself. Does that make sense? Well, instead of we are guessing, that's what I'm saying. Instead of trying to figure out what is God, who is God, would it make sense that God actually come here and tell us who he is and tell us why we are here for? Tell us that our life means something, counts something, and tell us something. Why all these problems happen? Why we have all these mischiefs? Wouldn't that make more sense? Now, if this God, shouldn't he come down to us and tell us who he is and how he handles us and what he wants us to do. That sounds like a brilliant idea, isn't it? But that makes sense, doesn't it? Yeah. And thus eventually God answered my inquiry that he did come down. He did tell us who he is and what he wants us to do. And this morning we talk about signs, and I want to show you something about signs. Next exercise, just to recast the meaning. I use English Standard Version. Certainly you can use a different version. I think Jeffrey has mentioned this, you know. Talking about the purpose of the book of John, that's the book that we are looking at in this gospel camp. And it talks about the purpose of sign. What is that sign is for? Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in these books. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So that's the purpose. So for God to tell us who he is, doesn't it make sense that he become like us to talk to us? You know, last year, I think I told the story about my dog. No. And I have another dog story to tell. No, I lost another dog. No, the dog was only 2 years old. No, and what happened was he actually had a common situation that his tummy, stomach was twisted because internally was twisted, and because it was twisted, so the gas cannot go through, and therefore his tummy start to blow. It's a common phenomenon called bloating, right? So the dog behaved very strange, in a lot of pain, and I look at the dog and try to understand what happened. At that time, I know the only way I can make the dog understand what I'm talking about is to become a dog, which I'm not. So I left him out and tried to comfort him and couldn't do anything until the following day, sent to the emergency and say that, no, it's beyond hope. No, that has to put to death. No, if God is higher than us, for us to know God, he has to come to us. And when he comes to us, well, he has to talk to us, right? Talk to us and say something that we can understand. Now, one of the most horrifying experiences in coming to United States, I came to United States at the age of 24. I still remember. I share this story so many times. So the first time I went to the supermarket, trying to find the toilet paper. But I didn't know how to say it in a way that they can understand. My pronunciation was too bad for people to understand. So I spent an hour in supermarket and went home empty-handed. Did not get my toilet paper. That's how bad it was. Talking about stress, and, make a living, this kind of stress. Can you imagine that a grown-up man at age of 24 cannot handle his own toilet paper? So that was sad. Why? Because my English, you can still hear my accent, obviously. But my English was really bad at that time. And I wish I could speak good English so that I can understand. For us to understand, God has to do something that's very human. But if God wants to tell us something about himself, which is not human, then he has to use sign. Does that make sense? That makes sense, isn't it? He has to use sign, otherwise, what? He showed us who he is, nobody can see. I'm only a human being. I have glasses, I have eyes, no, I touch. why am I supposed to know what does that mean to be invincible? I don't know, right? But for him to show everything is just simply on earth, well, then that's not exactly who God is. So he can only use sign. So Jesus did many signs. Signs are pointers, point to God. I think that makes a lot of sense. No. And he showed signs in the presence of disciples. So sign actually, one purpose for sign is for Christians. How many of you are already baptized Christians? Yes, actually these signs are for disciples to see, right? But not only for disciples, but also also written so that you may believe. Anybody who read it may believe. No, may believe. Believe what? And these are the two things. And I want you to ask yourself, do you believe this or not? Now, these are the two things. Believe Jesus is the Christ. That means who God sent to do the work of God, to rule, to redeem. He's from God with that authority. He is the one who God came down to us to explain to us who is God and what does he want us to do. You see, he is the one that from above to come down to us. And then he is the Son of God. So he himself has the full deity. So these are the two things. So now when you see Jesus, you know who God is. You know what God wants. And there's no mistake. And the inquiry of my youth, now God answered. I thought about how God communicates to us. The best way is for him to come. Be like me. And tell me something about him. And I want some authority. I don't just want somebody to come over and say, hey, I'm God. So give me $50. No, I don't want something like that. And so Jesus came and gave us these signs. And these signs to tell us those two things. And these are the things that you need to ask yourself, do you believe? No, that's the essence of this gospel camp, is do you believe? And if you believe, then you have something called life. Now, internal life, a life with God, life beyond this world. Even now, life that's very, very different. Today, this morning, we talk about life of joy. You know, and now I want to tell you a life that's satisfying. You know, satisfying, that's a good term. You know, most of us find life not very satisfying. We want something. We desire something. We like hungry people. You know, after eating, I want to eat more. After drinking, I want to drink more. No. If I have one party, I want my second party. No, you know what I'm talking about. Life seems to be a constant pursuing of something, but never satisfied. Now, that's actually kind of sad. No. But there's a life that's actually satisfying. Now, think about what I shared with you when I was young, when I was in elementary school, when I was 8, when I was in middle school, when I was in high school, in college, all those troubles, all those dissatisfaction, frustrations, angers. Now I find that satisfaction. One thing I make a vow to myself, since I'm not going to make a vow to God, so I make a vow to myself before I came to United States of America, was this, that I would never step in the church. So I make a vow in the name of my country. And now I'm a pastor, so it's just FYI. So if you think that you would never believe in Jesus Christ, maybe you're a very good pastoral candidate. Maybe we can talk in 10 years. So now, But God did not simply show sign to his disciples, and he also passed on, so written down, for us to see. And life is full of signs. And I cannot talk about too many signs, but I do want to share with you something. Next one. Signs are the words and works of Jesus. They are pointers. No, they point to who he is, as I just mentioned, and what he does. So that's what a sign for. And that's what I'm going to ask you to consider seriously tonight. Do you believe? If you believe seriously, there's no point to delay. Now is the time. Right? So now, in the Gospel of John, when there's a sign, generally, first is an action of Jesus on earth, you know, doing something, like turning water into wine. Right? That happened on earth. Now, turning water into wine. And then there's an explanation about what does that mean. So I think Jeffrey has mentioned this this morning. I just remind you again. But God, like I said, now these are the authentic biblical God-given signs. But I believe that God gave us signs that point to Jesus in many directions. And I'm going to, I thought about this. I thought about my experience. I thought about Jesus. And I want to share something with you. Next one. Now, you know this sign, right? What we are going to do is we are going to read John chapter 6. Now, the story I'm going to tell you is John 6. Now, what happened is that Jesus was on the side of the sea, and actually it's a lake, and a lot of people come trying to find him, you know, coming to him. He was sitting there with his disciple on the mountain with those who follow him, a very small crowd. Then he saw this big crowd emerging, coming to him, a large crowd, the crowd of 5,000 men. So with women and children, that would be 1,500. 15,000? No, that's kind of scary. If you saw that many people running to you, I would say that's pretty scary. Right. And why they come is because they saw signs that Jesus has healed the sick. So they saw Jesus did, but question is, do they understand? Do they understand? And I think that we are going to see these men, Jesus. Signs point to Jesus. Signs point to Jesus. Right? So how many of you have never heard of Jesus before? That before you came to the camp, that you have never heard of Jesus. So you all know Jesus, right? It's very good, very good. Now, I didn't realize this, no, but this man, Jesus, if we look at him purely from an earthly eye, then he's someone who died on the cross, right? That's it. Now, in United Nations, next one. Do you know what's this? Now, inscribe the purpose of United Nations. This is called Isaiah Wall. It was erected in 1948, 2 years after the establishment of United Nations. And what was written on there? Oh, you can see this in New York City, by the way. It's there. No, it's inscribed Isaiah chapter 2, verse 4. Isaiah is a book in the Bible. So what does he say? Next one. It was built and dedicated in 1948, like I say, in United Nations headquarters. United Nations was established in 1946. But at that time, they did not have a permanent location. You know? And, well, they had. But somebody in New York City dedicated the land. The guy named Rockefeller. Dedicated the land to United Nations. So they start the building. So they decide to move the permanent address to New York City, United Nations, and they started building and so on and so forth. So it was dedicated in 1948. This is what he said. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. So the purpose of United Nations came from the Bible. So this man died 2,000 years ago, has an impact to the world that beyond our own recognition. Have you ever think about what constitutes a great man? Like maybe Steve Jobs, the Apple founder, right? And iPhone, iPod, and so on and so forth. Maybe in 30 years, no, in 30 years, how many people do you think will remember Steve Jobs? In 100 years, how many people will recognize this name? Well, no, I mean, he only influenced technology. How about George Washington established a nation, impact a nation, right? And that's how many years ago? What? Oh, okay. Well, let's not take the history exam. It's less than 300 years, right? About 250. Now, this man died in 2,000 years ago, influenced United Nations. Can a dead man, a Jewish carpenter, crucified on the cross by the Roman soldier. At the moment of that history, it was nothing, because at one time, 2,000 Jews were crucified at one time. Many Jews got crucified. But this man impact United Nations, the purpose of United Nations. When you think about it, isn't that something about this person that goes beyond the physical? That Jesus is not just simply any great man with great thought. Now, next one. Now, can you read it or see it?
No.
This actually is the plague to commemorate the first General Assembly meeting of United Nations in 1946. What does he say? Next one. What's the first line? To the glory of God. No, I'm not saying that United Nations is the greatest Christian organization. Obviously, it's not. What I'm saying is that Jesus has an impact that's more than simply an individual person, a human being. And to the glory of God, and the smaller letter, and in prayer for peace on earth. In what? Prayer for peace on earth. For those who know the Bible, this come from Luke, right? When Jesus was born, glory to God, and peace on earth. So whether if you know Jesus or you don't know Jesus, so whether you believe in Jesus or you don't believe in Jesus, he has done something great for you. And he has done something great that beyond the imagination of any human authority, any human achiever, any president, any kings, any emperors, any inventors, any scientist. Now, so that's the first meeting. Now, where is it located? Do you know the first meeting? In the Methodist Central Hall, Westminster, in a church. The first United Nations Assembly was in a church. At that time, the Security Council headquarters is stationed in Anglican Church. Now, my point is not telling you, how great and wonderful Christian is. I just want to tell you that how great Christ is. Your daily life, your life points to Christ, that you may not know it. And next one, what is this? Yeah, the good old USA, right? But when you talk about good old USA, you need to talk about, next one. What? Mayflower. Mayflower. No. I never studied United States history. No, so I'm not going to test you on that. No. But Mayflower, they came here in 1620, about 400 years ago. And what's so incredible about that Mayflower is that they make a document called Mayflower Compact, right? So what does that say? Now this is the next one. This is the most important part. Most of people know the central part, the civil body politic. Well, this is modernized English, by the way. Originally it wasn't written like this. For our better ordering and the preservation and the furtherance of the ends aforesaid. So there are 41 who signed it. What they are saying is that everybody can have a say in how we should be governed. Now, that's 400 years ago. 400 years ago, every country was an empire. Every country has a king or emperor. And there's no idea about democracy. And they thought about it and they said, what? How come they have this idea? But do you know what they say in the beginning? Having undertaken, that means they came from England to United States, is for what purpose? Well, we can read together. Can you see? Is for what? For the glory of God. You see that again. And advancement of Christian faith. Now, again, I'm not talking whether the United States is a Christian country or not. That's not my point. My point is we are all here in the United States. And we are here because Jesus Christ has done something for us, even if we don't know it. The mere fact that you are here in the United States of America is saying something, pointing you to something of Jesus Christ that goes beyond just a physical being. And the next one. There's no next one. Next one is the Bible. So now we are going to come to take a look at the story. This is in John chapter 6. Now, in John chapter 6, so I'm going to explain to you, the chapter is pretty long, has 71 verses, if I remember correctly. And so it's a bit hard to do all the analysis here. So I'm going to just recapitulate for you. Now, trying to come with me, and trying to be there. Let's all come together. So as I said, that Jesus was there sitting on the mount. Actually, it's not a high mountain, more like here. Sitting there, and a lot of people have seen Jesus' signs, healing of people. Just like you have seen the sign of Jesus, that this man has an impact on the world, on the globe, to a scale that we scarcely can understand. And impact those even who do not believe. So a lot of people come to Jesus. A lot of people come to Jesus, as I said, they probably was more than 10,000, but 5,000 of them were men. So when they come, a lot of people come, and Jesus, so then did not come to join them, but he went up here, as I said. All right, so he went away. Another way is so that he on the hill is easier to talk to people. Right, so you got 5,000 people. Have you ever been a 5,000 people gathering? Football game maybe? Right, that can be 100,000, the largest. It's scary, It's 2,000 years ago, remember. So you got 10,000 people. So Jesus is on the mount and looking down, and he asks something about his disciple, which is very, very strange. Now, what did he say? This is what Jesus said. Now, chapter 6, verse 5, lifting up his eyes then, and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him. This is Jesus said. Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat?" Now, suppose you are Philip. What are you going to do? I mean, you got 10,000 people rushing to you, and you would expect your master is going to teach. They come to see Jesus, right? To say something. But first thing Jesus is saying that, well, we are going to feed them. We are going to give them bread. 10,000 people eating bread. How much bread do you think that will eat? And I mean, there's no ShopRite, okay? There's no Pathmark. What am I supposed to cook? What, you want a disciple to build a oven there and start cooking? No. And so he asks that Philip to say, feed them, basically. So that's very, very strange. Now, about this story, you are going to see the sign of Jesus, and you are going to see two reactions. The reaction of Jesus and the reaction of rejecting. As I said in the beginning, this is all for you to decide, for you to think about. Do you believe? If you so, follow it. So he asked his disciples, and what Philip said is this. He said to Jesus, now Philip answered him, 200 denarii would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. 200 denarii, that's for a normal worker, one day is one denarii. So 200 is about the 6.5 months worth of salary for a normal worker. No. So what Philip was saying that, in a very polite way, that you gotta be kidding. The task is too great. When you think about it, human hunger is something that, physical hunger, there are still people in hunger, right? We cannot solve that problem. No. And about the spiritual hunger, it's even less likely. The hunger that I had when I was young, when I was 8, when I was in elementary school, when I was in middle school, high school, college, came to United States. Who's going to solve that? It's hard, isn't it? And so Jesus said, hey, feed these 5,000. Feed them the bread. So Philip saying that, that's impossible. It's a very polite way to say no. And there's another disciple whose name is Andrew. So in verse 8, Andrew say back to Jesus, what he said is on verse 9, there is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they for so many? So if Philip was saying is that the task is so great, and what Andrew was saying is that my ability or our ability is too limited. The task, the things that you want us to do is impossible. And Andrew is saying that my ability is too little. And so this is what Jesus did. Then Jesus asked the disciple to do this. Set them down. Prepare them. Get them ready. And many of you are here because many Christians brought you here. Right? Get you ready. And so Jesus did not ask them to feed everybody. What Jesus asked disciples is to get them ready to receive. And that's what we are doing. And I'm not going to feed you anything. Jesus is going to feed you. What I'm doing is trying to get you ready. So I asked this, and then Jesus took that bread and took that fish, and he gave thanks and he blessed, and then he distributed to the 5,000. And everybody was fed and satisfied. And there was left over. That's the second thing that the disciples did. So Jesus asked the disciples to gather what is the leftover. And on verse 13, so they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. So disciples realized the abundance of supplication of what Jesus has done. No, the abundance of grace, that disciples knows that. And not only that, in the time of Jesus, when a rich guy, a person of high position, have a party, the leftover are for the servants to enjoy. So these guys, everybody got a basket. Remember, in the beginning, they only got 5 bread and 5 loaves and 2 fish, right? So now everybody got a basket. All these disciples got a basket for our food. No. So Jesus want them to set people ready and enjoy the fruit. No. And Jesus does the rest. So every God, now that's the sign. But now what happened? Here is the strange things happen. On verse 15, perceiving then that they were about to come, the crowd were about to come and take him, Jesus, by force, and making king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. So now Jesus, people come and want to make Jesus the king. And then, Jesus withdrew himself. That's very strange. That's counterintuitive to modern day. If somebody want to give you praise, elevate you up, give you glory, we accept it. We will say, I deserve it. But not Jesus yet step away. Now that gives us some question. Why? Why is that? No. And then in the following story, then Jesus started to explain there's a wrong way in understanding signs. And when you understand wrong, you don't get anything. And if you understand right, you will be like disciples. You will have life satisfied. You'll have the ability to do the things that's beyond your imagination. Do you remember the Mayflower things I mentioned? Actually, there was about 101-ish people on board, and traveled 66 days and landing in the wrong spot. They're supposed to land somewhere between Virginia and New York, but they land in Massachusetts. And imagine that. Those who signed the document, there are 41 person who signed the document. They were actually quite ordinary peoples. They were not like a great kings or great literature guys or any. They're just ordinary people. They were mostly from the same village in a British village. They are small people. They are small guys, small potatoes. Otherwise, the king is not going to permit them to leave the Church of England. And yet, can you imagine the impact that they have in this country and to the world? One of the things that we struggle with is we fear that, what are you supposed to do with your future? Eat and drink? Middle life, middle class life? You think about your life, you wonder, what is your life heading? Can you actually make a difference? Does the world need you? Are we going to say, just like Philip, the task is so great, or like Andrew, my strength is too little? Which we say that a lot. But in the hand of Jesus, miracles happen. And that's the life that's what satisfies us. But there's a wrong way of looking at the signs So now then Jesus actually passed that lake, go to a different place. And on verse 22, on the next day, the crowd remained on the other side of the sea. So Jesus crossed the lake. Those crowds did not realize it. Then suddenly they realized, wait, Jesus was gone. So they start to search for Jesus. And they found Jesus, so they took the boat and come over to Jesus. And verse 25, when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? And Jesus answered them. Now, this is very important. Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. You have not understood the signs. The signs point to Jesus. The two things that is Jesus is the Christ that God sent here to do the work of God. And he is the Son of God. He is God, is the full deity. These are the two things, the signs that point to there. If we don't see that, you don't see the signs. So have you seen the signs in your life and in the Bible? And if you see it, come and grab it. No, time to be satisfied by the life of Jesus Christ. No, time to know that even though I'm small, no, even though the task is great, and yet we, as Christians, we do make an impact on people's life to the world in eternity. That it has a value, goes beyond everything that we see. And this is what Jesus said in following. So he first saying that if you look at a sign with a wrong attitude, you thought, well, you come to me because you want to be filled. So you thought, oh, wow, Jesus is this wonderful God. So what does that mean? No, so that means I can go to the best school that I want. No, I can have the best toys that I want. I can have the nicest car, greatest job. No, is that what Jesus trying to tell us who he is and what he does? And no. He said that if you see signs like that, well then, you haven't seen the sign yet. And Jesus continued on verse 27, do not labor for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal. That Jesus was talking about himself. I come here to give you the eternal life. A life that satisfies, a life that will not hunger. No, all the spiritual hunger that I had when I was young is gone because of Jesus Christ. So that's what science is about. It's about Jesus Christ. And when you approach the sign in a wrong way, you haven't seen the sign yet. And if you don't see the sign as it is, then you haven't got eternal life and you haven't got a satisfaction. Then we keep on searching, keep on hungry, keep on frustrating, keep on wondering if what I'm doing has meaning or not. Keep on feeling that I'm so small, there are so little things that I can do. At the same time, I feel so great that everybody should serve me. And that kind of life leads nowhere, ends nowhere. It's not going to satisfy anybody. If you want to have a satisfied life, then come to Jesus. Recognize who he is. He's the one who died on the cross for our sins so that we can be forgiven. He's the one who died on the cross and resurrected so that we have eternal life. This is what Jesus did. And he came from God and was the Son of God. And on verse 35, Jesus make another declaration. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger. Whoever believes me shall never thirst. I am the bread of life. Bread of life means the bread that gives eternal life. So he say, Jesus saying that, I'm here for you. No. And Jesus used a metaphor. No, I am the one that God provides to give you eternal life, like the bread. And that's the decisions that we have to make. Now, not everybody follow Jesus. No, actually many of people fear that what Jesus said was hard. So they wander away. What do you want for your life? Now, what do you want for your life? That's a question I ask myself. No, ever since I was 8 till I was 26, what exactly do I want? Are there something that's really worth getting? Now, where am I heading? Where do I come from? What am I on this world for? And Jesus said that, come to me. Now, your destination is with me. And yet, you have to see me. And yet, you have to follow me. We might have too many things we don't want to give up. Now, I've heard many different reasons. Now, one person said that, no, I'm smoking. No, and I need to quit smoking. And I don't want to quit smoking. No, another person said that, you know what, I know I need to believe in Jesus. No. And I know that Christians talk about forgiveness. They talk about that we fall short of who God is and what God wants us to be. And we understand that God is the king and he judged the world, and we understand we deserve to be judged. Now, judgment is not a hard idea to understand. No, I'm actually not smart. Probably you can see that. One thing for people who are not smart and they want to do is what? They study, right? Why do you want to study so much? So that you can be smarter, isn't it? Right? So I study a lot. I'm 55. I'm still working on my second doctoral degree. But I have been working on it on and off. So finally, for any advanced degree, there's a period that you need to finish. Now, if you don't finish, something bad is going to happen. That is, the course that you took earlier, they discounted it. You have to retake it. And my time has expired. They gave me 6 years to finish. I didn't. So I wrote a letter to them, basically begging, see how poor I am. So please extend my graduation day. So they did. They were very nice. They said, okay, till the end of this year, you have to finish. Now, would you consider that as a favor? That's pretty kind, isn't it? And then they say that you will not be granted another extension. Now, would you consider that as too harsh? It makes sense, isn't it? So if Jesus came down to us and tell us that who he is and what he does, we see so many signs. Not only the signs as written on the scripture with the authority of God, but also even in our daily lives, in our living, that you see there's something about this Jesus came to be the savior of the world. And he invited us to believe, to join him, to trust him. And if we say no, and we be judged accordingly, I did many wrong things. No, I didn't kill anybody, but I certainly did a lot of stuff. Right? So everything, every wrong, especially the evil in our own heart. Now, we all know this, that anybody, whether if you're a 10 or you're 55 or even you're 60, if your family and your life can see your thought, every moment of your life, would you have friends? Would you have families? If your thought life is transparent to everybody, would anybody, and all the time, would anybody want to be friends with you? So our problem is not only our behavior, but also our thought, right? And but before God, nothing can hide. So he came, so he died to say that there's price to pay because he's the king of the world. And one authority for king to do is to judge, judge fairly. That's what the king does. At least a good king does that. So the king judged to give reward and the king judged to give punishment. And so just like I asked for graduation extension and was granted, that's a good news. And if I ignore the call for me to finish, and then 6 months, no, less than 6 months, 3 months later, I asked for extension again, and I was denied. Should I jump up and down to say, I know that this is nonsense. I know, God is harsh. God is stupid. There's no God. Does that make sense? That doesn't make sense. Jesus come to seek us, to die for us, and resurrected, to give us the sign, to tell us that he is not simply a human being. He is a human being so that we can see who God is. He can be with us, be our representative, but he's more than that. He is the Son of God. Come down to the world. So carry that authority. If you know, want to know who God is, the best way is for God to come down and to tell us. And he did that. And the best way is for him to give us signs. And he did that. And the best way is for him to give us other people to say that it's true. And he did that. So, why not take it? This is the sign of life. A life of joy, a life of satisfaction. At one point of my life, the first year when I came to the United States, that's when I was 25. My brother came here earlier to New Jersey, actually, in New Jersey, actually. He got married already. And I didn't know that. It's only later that I realized for my sister-in-law, spoke to my brother and said, well, are you going to do something about it? Because I think he was going to commit suicide. Actually, I wasn't. I wasn't happy, but I wasn't thinking about suicidal. But I certainly was miserable. Life was not satisfying. And there's no need to turn to the age of 26 to realize that. But there's no need to do that. There's no need to go through life like that with all the questions and the troubles. Well, when the living water has been offered to us, when the bread of life has come down to us, when Jesus has given us the signs and asked us to come. So now it's time to come. Come to the bread of life. Come to the feast of God. Come and confess. Yes, you might be small, but you are going to do something really strange and mighty. Throughout my life, I have never imagined I will preach in English. Actually, I hate it. Some people hear me preaching also hate it, but that's a different story. And I got that same feeling whenever I do this. I thought about the five loaves and two fishes. No, I thought about Philip and Andrew, the task is so great, and my ability is so little. And yet there's something great and wonderful that goes beyond us, goes beyond you. Now we always compare to others. I'm shorter, I'm weaker, I'm not strong enough. And the only way to showcase me is to be stronger, to be taller, to be greater, to have a better grade, to go to a great school. But I'm not saying that it's totally useless, but life is more than that. Life of Christ, life with God, internal life from Jesus Christ. So now, think about this. And now, come and make a decision. Some of you have not, you've been in the church all along. You even consider yourself a Christian. How many of you who are not baptized but thought that would consider yourself a Christian? Oh, we have quite a few. Then you know what you need to do is to be what? Baptized, right? That's pretty straightforward. There's no need to wait. Well, this is the t-shirt for this camp. Once you get it, you put on it. There's no need to wait. You consider yourself Christian, be baptized. There's no need to wait. And some of you that you have come here, that you don't consider yourself a Christian, in particular to you, say, come, eat the bread. Now is the time. I don't know who you are. No, but I'm going to pray, and I'm going to invite you to join me in praying. And if you are making that decision today to come to the bread of life, we pray, we bow down, you raise your hand, and I'll pray for you. And you pray with me as well. We pray together before God. Come and grab this life. Now answer this invitation. Come to Jesus. Eat the bread. Now enjoy your life. Be satisfied. In a way, not because a wrong way that you want a better grade. No, come to the internal life. Make your life count for something. No. Don't become a nothingness. Become something in the hand of Jesus Christ. With all the limitation, with the great task lie before us, with the impossibility in our mind, and yet with the strength of Jesus Christ from above and in us. Come, and now is the time. So should we bow down and pray and make that decision and raise your hand, and then we give praise to God. So let's bow down and I will pray. And Father, listen to our cry and listen to our prayer. We have this internal thirst, a thirst that we may not always understand. But now we do know that in you we find that satisfaction, the bread of life from Jesus Christ, who is Jesus Christ. We confess ourselves before you. We confess who you are and what you are doing for us. And now for those who among us want to make that decision, would you please raise your hand? You only need to raise your hand and just put down so that I will pray for you. Praise the Lord. No. So raise your hand. We have one, we have two, we have three. Just raise your hand and I will pray for you. And now, once you raise it, you can put down. You don't have to stay here. God knows it. No. If you raise your hand, just put down and praise the Lord. No. If you, this is the time to eat the bread. No. You want to come. You have that desire. No. Don't worry about, you can put down. Don't let your hand stay there. Just raise and put down. Just raise and put down. No. It's to make a commitment to Jesus Christ. That's what we do. No, it's not for us to see, but raise your hand. No, if you want, make that commitment. And just raise your hand and put down. Just raise your hand and put down. Don't let your hand stand. Praise the Lord. No, we really thank God for this great and wonderful harvest. Are there more? No, we have 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. If you trust in Him, now is the time to have that life. Come and eat and drink and be satisfied. So now let's pray. Now we leave out all these those who made that decision before God. So let's pray together. And Father, we thank you that you sent Jesus down for us to have that internal life. And today, many of us have made that commitment and made that decision. And we trust, Lord, that you will satisfy us with that internal life. For you have promised us those who come to you will not be hungry and will never be thirsty. And so we pray and we give thanks to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, as you have raised your hand, you come from different churches. Now, I understand that, and maybe you have even more questions. I actually lose count. I don't know, we have 10, maybe more. You come from different churches, come from different places. So make sure that you talk to your group leader, so that we can help you. We have something to give to you, so that you know what to do next. Once I have internal life, we also, if you agree, we want to let the church know, the church or your fellowship group that you come from, know, so that they will also be able to help you. But congratulations and praise the Lord. I'm very happy. 26 years ago, I made that commitment. And 29 years ago, and life has been